Christ yesterday and today, the beginning and the end, Alpha and Omega, all time belongs to him and all ages. To him be glory and power through every age and forever. Amen. Welcome to Holminster Online for Easter Sunday, a day when we remember Jesus' victory over sin and death. This great day when life and love wins over all. We're going to hear the great Easter hymn, Jesus Christ is Risen Today. Let us pray that we may walk the risen life of Christ in glory. God of glory, by the raising of your Son, you have broken the chains of death and hell. Fill your church with faith and hope, for a new day has dawned, and the way of life stands open in our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen. Christ died to sin for all, and now he lives to God. Let us renew our resolve to have done with all that is evil and confess our sins in penitence and faith. Like Mary at the empty tomb, we fail to grasp the wonder of your presence. Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. Like the disciples behind locked doors, we are afraid to be seen as your followers. Christ, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Like Thomas in the upper room, we are slow to believe. Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. May the God of love and power, forgive you and free you from your sins, heal and strengthen you by his Spirit, and raise you to new life in Christ. Amen.
Today's reading is taken from Acts chapter 10, verses 34 to 43. Then Peter began to speak. I now realise how true it is that God does not show favouritism, but accepts from every nation the one who fears him and does what is right. You know the message God sent to the people of Israel, announcing the good news of peace through Jesus Christ, who is Lord of all. You know what has happened throughout the province of Judea, beginning in Galilee, after the baptism that John preached, how God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and power, and how he went around doing good in healing all who were under the power of the devil, because God was with him. We are witnesses of everything he did in the country of the Jews and in Jerusalem. They killed him by hanging him on a cross, but God raised him from the dead on the third day and caused him to be seen. He was not seen by all the people, but by witnesses whom God had already chosen, by us who ate and drank with him after he rose from the dead. He commanded us to preach to the people and to testify that he is the one whom God appointed as judge of the living and the dead. All the prophets testify about him, that everyone who believes in him receives forgiveness of sins through his name. While Peter was still speaking these words, the Holy Spirit came on all who heard the message. The circumcised believers who had come with Peter were astonished that the gift of the Holy Spirit had been poured out even on Gentiles. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Christ, our Passover has been sacrificed for us, so let us celebrate the feast, not with the old leaven of corruption and wickedness, but with the unleavened bread of sincerity and truth. Christ, once raised from the dead, dies no more. Death has no more dominion over him. In dying, he died to sin once for all. In living, he lives to God. See yourselves, therefore, as dead to sin and alive to God in Jesus Christ our Lord. Christ has been raised from the dead, the firstfruits of those who sleep. For as by man came death, by man has come also the resurrection of the dead. For as in Adam all die, even so in Christ shall all be made alive. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and shall be forever. Amen.
The second reading is from the Gospel of John, chapter 20, beginning to read at verse 1. Early on the first day of the week, while it was still dark, Mary Magdalene went to the tomb and saw that the stone had been removed from the entrance. So she came running to Simon Peter and the other disciple, the one Jesus loved, and said, "They have taken the Lord out of the tomb, and we don't know where they have put him." So Peter and the other disciple started for the tomb. Both were running, but the other disciple outran Peter and reached the tomb first. He bent over and looked in at the strips of linen lying there, but did not go in. Then Simon Peter came along behind him and went straight into the tomb. He saw the strips of linen lying there, as well as a cloth that had been wrapped around Jesus' head. The cloth was still lying in its place, separate from the linen. Finally, the other disciple, who had reached the tomb first, also went inside. He saw and believed. They still did not understand from Scripture that Jesus had to rise from the dead. Then the disciples went back to where they were staying. Now Mary stood outside the tomb, crying. As she wept, she bent over to look into the tomb and saw two angels in white seated where Jesus' body had been, one at the head and the other at the foot. They asked her, "Woman, why are you crying?" "They have taken my Lord away," she said, "and I don't know where they've put him." At this she turned around and saw Jesus standing there, but she did not realize that it was Jesus. He asked her, "Woman, why are you crying? Who is it you are looking for?" Thinking he was a gardener, she said, "Sir, if you've carried him away, tell me where you have put him, and I will get him." Jesus said to her, "Mary." She turned towards him and cried out in Aramaic, "Rabboni," which means teacher. Jesus said, "Do not hold on to me, for I have not yet ascended to the Father. Go instead to my brothers and tell them, I am ascending to my Father and your Father, to my God and your God." Mary Magdalene went to the disciples with the news, "I have seen the Lord," and she told them that he had said these things to her. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Alleluia, Christ is risen. We come to the climax of Holy Week, the resurrection of Jesus. This past week we've journeyed through ups and downs, beginning with Palm Sunday, last Sunday, where Jesus entered into Jerusalem and the people praised him and said, "Hosanna to the King of David." Then as we travelled through that week, we saw Jesus very humbly washing the feet of his disciples, then sharing a meal with them, the meal where Judas showed that he was the one to betray Jesus. And on Good Friday, our Lord was crucified. But today, we come to Easter Day, the day that changed Mary's life and brought her to see the glory of the risen Lord. The day that changed many lives, because Mary was to share that good news with others. Mary had started that day in tears. She was weeping for her dear friend, Jesus. She thought she'd never see him again, and she was distraught. She felt that terrible loss and emptiness that we all will have felt at some point in our lives when we've lost someone very close to us. But then what she sees when she comes to the tomb really shakes her to the core. The tomb is empty. Jesus' body is not there, and the linen cloths that he was wrapped in are folded and in the tomb. Now that tomb is empty. Her first thoughts were to run and tell Simon Peter and John, the beloved disciple of Jesus, his two closest friends, to share with them, because none of this makes any sense to her. Maybe they can help her. And when she returns to the tomb, the scripture says, "But Mary stood weeping outside the tomb." She's overcome by the sadness, the tears, maybe tears of desperation now that she doesn't know where her friend Jesus is laid. But when she turns round, Jesus sees her. She sees him, but she doesn't know it is him. And he asks her, "Why are you weeping?" In her darkest hour, Jesus is there for her. The one who heals speaks to the one in pain. The one who comforts speaks to the one who grieves. "They have taken my Lord away, and I do not know where they have put him." She's confused until Jesus, who she thinks is the gardener, speaks to her, and he says one word. He says, "Mary." She knows that this is no other than Jesus speaking to her, when she hears that single word, Mary. Jesus tells her she must let go, not to hold on to him physically, but to trust in God for the ongoing journey that started that day. Jesus chose Mary to be the first one to see him. Mary, a woman not equal with the men in those days. But Mary is the one that takes the message of the risen Lord to the others. And it's important here that it's worth noting this was Jesus speaking to Mary, but he also speaks to us. In our pain, in our loss, he's there. He was there for Mary, and likewise, he's here for us. And we never must feel not good enough for Jesus. For Jesus, you don't have to have the right credentials or mix with the right people. The one thing for sure that in his human life, Jesus sought out those that were marginalized. He befriended the women whom he helped, the woman at the well, the unclean, those that were marginalized. He was there. He was their friend. He was with them. So never feel you're not good enough for Jesus. We are. Mary mistook Jesus for the gardener, not realizing at that moment it was the beginning of something new. A new ministry begins at that moment, a new story. Is Jesus asking the same question of us this Easter morning? What are we looking for? Who are we looking for? It was when Jesus called Mary by name that she realized it was her beloved friend, Jesus. Is Jesus calling your name or my name today? Are we being called to see the new things that God is doing in our lives and in the world? Do we always recognize Jesus in the midst of our lives and our communities? Or do things stop us from seeing clearly? So many other things going on, so many distractions that sometimes we can't see and we can't hear what we need to hear. Jesus became recognizable when he said Mary's name. She instantly knew it was Jesus. Is Jesus calling our name today? What can we do to make it more likely that we will hear him calling us so we can reach out and we can see the glorified Lord? In this new creation, this new day, Jesus sends Mary out of the garden rejoicing. She's sent out to tell everyone the darkness has not overcome the Word made flesh who had lived among us. We've moved on from Good Friday to the risen Lord. She'd seen her rabbi, and now she understood that she had seen the glory as of a Father's only Son, full of grace and truth. I have seen the Lord. A message declares to us the new beginning that God prepared for all of us, an invitation for us to share in the glory of the risen Lord. On Easter Day, Christ went from death to new life. The outer shell was broken so that we can go and rejoice like Mary did in the glory that God has had to offer and has to offer today. We remember that we sing when I stand in glory, I will see his face, and there I'll serve my King forever in that holy place. That's the offer of Easter Day. Let's take it with hands open and receive the message of Jesus into our hearts today. Amen.
Let's pray together. Scripture says, "Yet for us there is but one God, the Father, from whom all things came and for whom we live. And there is but one Lord, Jesus Christ, through whom all things came and through whom we live. Father God, we thank you that through Christ we are free from guilt and shame, and we can come to you in prayer. And we do pray that we may be enablers of others also to live in freedom of guilt and shame. We think of anyone we know now who is struggling at this time, who may be ill or distressed or angry or lost. We pray that the great freedom that is from Christ might come to them, and that you will rest your healing hands on the people known to us this day who need your help and your care. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. And Father, we thank you for this great world of ours, the many nations and peoples. Yet there are so many places in trouble. We pray for them now. We pray for the migrant communities on Lesbos. They struggle to recover from the fire in their camp and the discord that has arisen in that island. We pray for those struggling with the fires in California and the continued threat of coronavirus, especially in Brazil and India. Father, we lift these nations to you and the peoples affected by such terrible things. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. And for our own nation at this time, Father, we pray especially for children and young people after their return to school and to college. We pray that you'll be with them, that you'll help them still to enjoy their youth and their childhoods, and that we as a nation will provide a secure and loving base for people to grow up in this time. And as a nation, may we come together in some way to promote peace and wisdom and justice and all those things that are of you at this time. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. And Father, we bring to you our church, this wonderful Holminster. We pray especially at this time for our financial difficulties and the ways that the virus has impacted on our plans and ideas and hopes. We pray that you help us understand the right courses of action, and we pray for all those affected. Lord, we pray for our Minster and our church community. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. And so, Father, we gather our prayers into one this morning in the Lord's Prayer as we say together, Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Let us proclaim the faith of the church, the faith of the risen Lord. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Thank you for joining us online for this Easter celebration. Next week, we're back to our normal run of services, Wednesday at 12:30 here in church, and 10 o'clock online and 10:30 on Sunday. We're hoping from the 18th of April to begin again our Saturday evening services and our new Sunday Church at Four service of a more contemporary nature. If you're able to give to the work and ministry here at the Minster, you'll find the details for that on the screen now and at the end. But basically, if you go to wholeminster.org give, you'll find the different ways to contribute to that work. So let us pray for God's blessing upon you and upon your family and friends as you begin to meet up with them once more. God, who through the resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ has given us the victory, give you joy and peace in your faith, and the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be amongst you and remain with you always. Amen.